You're listening to Metal Matters, a weekly Gimme Radio podcast. I'm your host, Mike Hill. If you like metal, punk, hardcore, or anything extreme, you've come to the right place. So subscribe and never miss out. Once again, it's time for another episode of Metal Matters. I'd like to thank everyone who's been listening and sharing. I can see the numbers. I can see you guys sharing, and it means a lot. Thank you very much, and I hope you guys are enjoying this. This week, Jonah Jenkins joins us to talk about Prone Mortal Form, the debut record of Only Living Witness. If you were in the New England area in the late 80s and early 90s, Witness is one of those bands that you were seeing playing these gigantic shows. They were one of the more influential bands at the time, and they were harbingers of a new sound that was sort of developing in the hardcore scene. They brought in this new sound and are definitely one of the bands that were on the cutting edge around that time. I wanted to get this episode out to you guys because there's some activity with Milltown, one of Jonah's post-Only Living Witness bands, and wanted to get this out to you guys, so here we go. So the band formed in 1989 in Boston, and it was former members of the band, the thrash band Formicide, and Prone Mortal Form came out on Century Media May 21st, 1993. It's 35 minutes and 27 seconds long, which is, that's an interesting point because lately records, like full-length LPs, are like 70 minutes long these days, and Prone Mortal Form is definitely of that era, i.e. Slayer and bands like that, that put out the 35-minute records.
That was on purpose, definitely.
Yeah. So, in the beginning of the band, well, first of all, Only Living Witness is a very influential band, especially in New England. And when I think of Only Living Witness, I think of Sam Black Church as being two bands that did not sound very much like hardcore music in the late 80s. I mean, the band formed in 89, and leading up to that, in Boston at least, you had Wrecking Crew, Slapshot, Gangrene, Eye for an Eye, you know, bands like that. And then Only Living Witness sort of comes on the scene with a completely different sound. And I just like to talk about that, like what, you know, what sort of angle you guys were coming at to make the band sound so different.
Yeah, well, I had been doing a fanzine with some friends for a while. You know, we were just kind of writing about and reviewing music that, you know, maybe started from the heavier perspective, hardcore punk rock, metal, very early black metal, you know, grindcore, power violence, that kind of stuff. And then we would always throw in other kinds of music in there because we didn't have very limited tastes. You know, we would always have top 10 lists that included Sade, usually, you know, along with Bolt Thrower, Stark Wither, Winter. You know, we really had quite broad tastes. You know, we would talk about Joe Jackson in the same sentence. We'd be talking about Slayer. So we didn't feel like we needed to limit our content. So we called it Look Again, which was the whole idea was, you know, take another look at what you might have as a prejudice against this music, because it's probably got some merit, you know, if someone bothered to release this thing. That's not to say that everything that was getting released was good, but at least there's something that you might find that you like about it, and we're trying to present the things that are kind of across the whole spectrum so that you can gain some knowledge about where music is in the world, not just what your microcosm, your subculture, your, you know, myopic worldview is telling you. So I had been a fan of Formicide since I was in high school, went to go see them and met them. They were really cool. And, you know, we started the fanzine just as high school was ending for me. And, you know, I sang in a band that never really did anything. And that was just a couple of shows, but we did a demo, and the Formicide guys had heard that, and they wanted to change their direction from the straight up thrash metal to more stripped down, E-trope, Leeway, you know, I don't know, there's a whole bunch of bands I could rattle up here, Holy Terror, obviously Slayer. But those were the initial bands we started talking about when Only the Witness started to form. It was basically me with the Formicide guys, and we specifically said that, you know, that a lot of the riffs were working really well, but they didn't want to have like a guy hitting those Dio type notes on the recordings. I mean, the guy could sing his ass off. Steve Rappucci is an incredible vocalist, but they wanted something more straightforward, and I could bark pretty well, so I just kind of barked along with it. And so we were still in that sort of thrash vein for quite a while, and those are the first shows we played in Boston hardcore. Sean McNally helped us to get shows. Tim Katz, who used to be in Seika, he helped us to get some shows. And, you know, we started playing the Channel and the Rat and playing hardcore shows. And even though we weren't really a hardcore band at all, the hardcore scene is what I had been a part of since whatever, 84, 85, just as a little kid, you know, going to shows. And it was a logical place for me because I had contacts from the fanzine to try and, you know, ask for shows and bring shows together and kind of create eclectic shows that I wanted to see. You know, when we heard Santa Black Church demo, I was just blown away, and I got it through a friend John Sandler, who I was doing the fanzine with, and we started writing about them because they just, you know, pieces of stuff. So we would and book shows, witness shows, with bands that we thought might kind of push boundaries for people, and it kind of worked out pretty well, especially with Sean McNally helping us out with getting bigger rooms and bringing bigger shows together. One of the best shows that John Sandler and I booked was it was Sabbath Church, Only the Witness, STP, Over and Out. I forget who else was on that show, but it was really good. And that was a Bun Ready show, and definitely cut across a bunch of different lines that people did not expect. It was Starkweather played that show too. People hadn't seen that really heavy, I guess, more metal or more thrash or whatever you want to call it, or doom style of Starkweather especially. And then Sam Black Church were kind of off the map. People didn't know what to make of them being almost like a grindcore band with like an HR type singer. So Witness fit into that little thing pretty well. And then we kind of, you know, got better shows from there. It was kind of ground zero for when we started getting really good shows.
What was your background as a vocalist? Because that's really one of the most impressive things about the band, I think, is just the vocal range you have. And, you know, so did you actually study anything? Like, did you have any formal training in singing?
Around the time that Only the Witness got together, we liked a lot of different kinds of music. We liked melodic music. We always talked about Sabbath, and we always talked about the Beatles and stuff like that. But we weren't playing music that really could accommodate that when we were still a thrash band. You know, Witness started out with basically the thrash band with me on vocals, but I was barking a lot. And as we started to write a little bit more melodic music, that changed our writing style enough that we actually changed out our bass player and our guitar player. And then we started tuning down, and it got a little bit more melodic in general because we were slowing down as well. And I was able to experiment a little bit more. And I think that tuning down gave me a chance to sing high without having to be in that, you know, standard E tuning where I had to sing way higher. And we would tune down to whatever drop D and C, and it was easier for me to hit some notes in there. And then I could relax a little bit more. I wasn't having to just yell and scream all the time to be heard. There was some space in the music, and I could sing out a little bit more. So that's really what led to it. I had been singing along to records for a long time. I liked, you know, a lot of melodic hardcore and punk rock, Bad Brains, Straw Dogs, Misfits, you know, FUs. Those are definitely the ones that got me to understand that it can be melodic, even Fear, you know. I mean, these are all bands with really great vocals. And I wanted to sing along to them, and I wanted to write music that captured some of that energy, but still was melodic and catchy.
Yeah, it's funny that when you mentioned the tuning aspect of being in tune when you sing, because I'd experienced something similar to that when confronted with covering a Danzig song or a Samhain song with my own band, Tombs. We covered Mother of Mercy, and we tried to do it in the standard tuning that Samhain recorded it in. There was no possible way for me to hit those high notes. So we tuned it down to C, and I'm like, oh, suddenly I can sing this thing, and I sound okay
there
now.
There you go.
That's pretty funny.
A big difference. Yeah, I mean, a lot of people don't realize that when they listen along to records like, you know, like Sabbath records. I mean, Sabbath were tuning down pretty much ever since their whatever Master Reality and, you know, definitely Volume 4. There's some really low tunings in those records, and Ozzy sounds great. But, you know, in a standard tuning, it doesn't sound as great. Same thing with Soundgarden. They hadn't played in E since, what, 1987? I mean, Chris Carlson, he's a hell of a vocalist, but he certainly sounds better when he can kind of sing along to this detuned, you know, more open and slow music than when he's singing along just in the same tuning as Elvis Costello.
So who was, there were some member changes in the beginning of the band until when you guys recorded Prone Mortal Form. So what was the two lineups that actually were involved in the band, like from the beginning, the demos, and yeah?
The first lineup was Eric Stevenson on drums, me on vocals, Roy Costa on bass, and Kevin Stevenson on guitar. Kevin and Eric were brothers, and all three of those guys were the original lineup for Formicide. The next lineup was me and Eric, and the guitar player is Craig Silverman, and the bass player, Chris Crowley. And both of them were from other local metal bands, and they, you know, we recognized that they were incredible players, and we wanted to see how it would work. So when we first started practicing, we played some of the songs that we had written with Rory and Kevin. We played, you know, not all of them, but many of them, and it worked because they could play the faster, thrashier stuff, but they also brought something new to the slower and more detuned and open songs.
You know, it's funny, back in the early 90s, I mean, I moved to Boston in, I think it was 93 or 94, somewhere along that line, where a lot of bands that were from the hardcore scene seemed to be in love with, like, rock music again, you know what I mean? And
yeah.
And it was this sort of era of bands, like, around that time. Like, even bands that had existed in the 80s, once it became mm-hmm. 1990, 91, suddenly they were introducing more metal, a little bit more, you know, sort of, you know, melodic singing, and the tempos were dropping mm-hmm. a little bit, and the tunings were dropping, and all that sort of stuff. So, I mean, in a way, I feel like, I mean, just as a pure outsider, because I didn't grow up in Boston, I was there for a little bit during the 80s in college, but I kind of felt like Witness was like a harbinger of that style of music. I feel like, you know, seriously, I mean, you know, some of the funnest builds I've ever seen were you guys and Sam Black Church, like two bands mm-hmm. that sound completely different. Yet yeah. you guys, I feel like SBC and you guys played quite a bit.
We did. We're pretty good friends, and we tried to help each other as much as possible.
Yeah. And then Sean Cringe was like a huge, Sean McNally was a huge figure back then too. I mean, he was booking shows, like he managed Sam Black Church, I think. And was he involved with Only Live a Witness as well on a management level, or?
No, he didn't manage us, but he definitely helped us out. I mean, I gave him the Sam Black Church demo. He hadn't heard them before. I gave that to him. We played a show of his at Green Street Station. And I think, you know, 11 people showed up, but we got paid like $11. And I was like, thank you very much for this show. I really appreciate it, but you really got to hear this band. And I gave him my copy of Sam Black Church Jet Metal demo. And he was like, oh, okay, I'll check it out. And then, you know, fast forward, you know, a few shows, and he's booking them at Green Street, and then things went well. And then I think Mark McKay was at the same show that I was at, where it was Sam Black Church playing to, like, you know, I think maybe Steve Malone was there, and maybe four other people, including me and Mark McKay and Sean. And they quickly, you know, Mark McKay offered to put out a 7-inch for them on the same label where he had put out that Wrecking Crew 7-inch. Grinding Halt, is that what it was? Basically the it snowballed from there, because we always put a play together. We were basically friends as well as, you know, fans of each other, and worked really well for a really long time.
Now, the relationship with Century Media, mm-hmm. I gotta be honest with you. Only the Witness yep. was the first band I'd ever heard. Like, you guys being signed to Century Media is what made me aware of what Century Media was as a label. And now they're this, you know, sort of mega label these days. So a primarily European label, how did Witness get on the radar of Century Media?
So I think that we had a lawyer I think at the time that was not in the music business. So I know that we didn't have any management. We didn't have anyone really helping us out. The only thing that I could think of is maybe they got a copy of A Look Again where we had a Witness interview in there. Then they maybe found it through tape trading, because I didn't send them anything. I think we sent something to Maze, because like Biohazard was signed to Maze, and I think they were looking at Wrecking Crew. But we didn't send it out to many labels at all. I think we sent it to Roadrunner, because Formicide had sent some music to Roadrunner. We had some contacts in common, but I have no idea how they actually got. But I got a phone call from them, from Robert, and he was like, "Hey, you know, we're a label out of Germany. We have about 10 releases," I think he said, something like that. And he knew that I liked death metal, and so we started talking about music, and I was, you know, totally into a lot of that early Century Media stuff. I really didn't even know their history. I didn't know who Oliver was. I didn't know anything about their whole MO. So it ended up, you know, in the long run working out for the best, because we were able to tour Europe a couple of times, and that was awesome. But we definitely didn't fit on the label, especially back when they were almost entirely death metal.
Yeah.
And then when we tried to move away from the label, they held on to us really tightly, and that had a lot to do with the band breaking up, but there were other factors as well. But the record label was both a huge facilitator for us and gave us a chance to tour, because we didn't really tour at all in the U.S., mainly because they didn't want us to, they wanted us to sign away our merch in the U.S., and because we didn't sign away our merch in the U.S., they refused to give us tour support in the U.S.
Wow.
But we did sign away our merch in Europe, so they were like, yeah, sure, come on over and, you know, tour and we'll sell your merch.
Damn, that's that was going to be a question I had, because I know that, or my understanding was that Only Living Witness didn't really tour extensively in the United States, and I guess that's the reason why.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, we made a video and everything on our own, and they wouldn't even pay us for that. They were like, "Nah, just give us." You know, and it was $300. it was weird, you know, because they held on to us so tightly and wanted so much money for us to leave to be on another label, when all we wanted to do is just continue and even have pretty modest budgets. We recorded the first record for $10,000. Second record was $35,000, and that included buying gear. So it's like, compared to nowadays, where, I mean, and this is, you know, when Fort Apache was, I think, $1,000 a day or $1,500 a day, something like that.
Yeah.
So we weren't exactly, those weren't exactly big budgets, especially for, you know, 2-inch tape recording. And it certainly, we signed too soon. You know, we signed in 92, and I think that was the same year that Nirvana broke. And if we had waited, you know, maybe 6 months to 8 months, we probably would have had, you know, better offers even from other labels, because we easily sold 500 copies of our first demo. And I think when our first album came out, we sold maybe 2,000 copies. And once we sold those 2,000 copies, Century Media was like, okay, that's enough. Give us another record now. And that was like 3 months later.
Wow.
So, yeah, it was like really weird interactions, because I think they were just used to the underground selling the records for you. They didn't have any concept of promotion, really. And certainly tape trading gave them all that, you know, Unleashed, Grave, all those bands, Morgoth. Those were selling because people knew the demos and people were doing tape trading and stuff. It wasn't because of some massive promotional machine yet. Although I will give huge credit to Paula and Eula from Century Media, who made it their personal, you know, mission to promote Witness. They really worked hard for us, and a lot of people at Century Media, especially in the smaller U.S. office when they were in New York, they've worked really hard to get Witness onto the radio, and that definitely helped. But, you know, without touring, it wasn't going to be much more than that. And they definitely didn't do any paper zine advertising. So there wasn't really much way to get any traction without touring. So we really toured in the Northeast. The farthest north we went was Montreal. Farthest south was Philly. And the farthest west we went was Albany.
Wow. Yeah. Did you guys have desires to tour the whole states?
it would have been cool, I think, especially if we did it when everyone was energized. But Eric had a lot of physical health problems, and it was not easy for him to tour, and he didn't really like touring. So it was also a challenge within the band. I can't blame him for that. Definitely was not easy for him physically to tour. So it didn't help the situation. If we had been super motivated and wanted to go and do like the guys in Tree did and Sam Black Church did and just pick up and go tour on our own, we definitely could have done that. But it would have been a significant challenge for Eric physically.
Related to, well, actually unrelated, how did you meet Will Tarrant, our mutual friend Will, who ran Chainsaw Safety Records, and he put out one of your 7-inches? Yeah. How did you guys meet?
Yeah, well, he was good friends with Eric, and he introduced Will to me. Will came to see us at our first show in Worcester. I think we played it the only time. But incidentally, Will and I started talking because of the zine stuff. You know, he did a fanzine a long time ago. When I was doing a fanzine, we would trade tapes and trade records and stuff. And he actually is the person who named Only Living Witness. He came up with that name.
Really?
Yeah.
That's pretty interesting, actually. Because how did he come up with the name? Like, what's the story behind that?
I'm pretty sure he read the Ted Bundy book.
Okay.
it's the name of the Ted Bundy book. And it was just kind of unique at the time. Not a lot of people were using the three words that have now turned into three totally disconnected words often. But it kind of made sense for the style of music that we're doing. One of our first songs was about the Zodiac Killer, so there's a slight relationship there. And also as a result, we ended up connecting with the Starkweather people because of the name.
Right.
We weren't all about serial killers or anything like that, but it flowed and it was unique at the time.
If I remember correctly, that early 90s period, late 80s, early 90s, there was a serial killer fascination. There was like this kind of underground, you had Answer Me, you had, all these different sort of underground magazines and publications. And I felt like true crime was like sort of coming into this very sort of hip sort of place, with like younger people, bands, music, that sort of thing. Charles Manson, Ted Bundy, Charles Starkweather, this sort of stuff coming together. And damn, something? You mentioned Starkweather. It blows my mind sometimes how long that band has been around and they're still operating.
I know. It's amazing. And still good.
Yeah, it's for the best. I think the world needs a band like Starkweather for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The recording of the record, where did you record it, Fort Apache?
We did. The first one was Fort Apache.
Yeah, okay. Who was the producer on that record?
Tim O'Hare.
Yeah, and Tim O'Hare is worked on a bunch of records around that time, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, he did. Yeah. Also, hugely influential to us, and a big help in the recording of the album was also Carl Plaster. He was the drum engineer, and he had lots and lots of suggestions for us and helped us to make Eric's drums sound as huge as they did. And also, he understood the music, great presence in the studio. So we were very lucky to work with him as well.
Yeah, Carl Plaster was kind of a big figure in Boston around that time. Like, he was, he played a part in a lot of great recordings that were coming out of Fort Apache, in my opinion, and he also would engineer, pipeline sessions and things like that. You know what I mean? Every now and then he'd pop up. And I feel like in that period of time, there was a lot of really good music coming out of Boston. So what were some of the other bands and artists that you appreciated from that time?
Well, I really loved the first Seika record. I thought it was badass. And the demos, those are just incredible songs. The very early Maelstrom stuff, I loved it. It really blew my mind. I liked Eye for an Eye. It was good, but I really preferred La Gratona. That was more towards the end of Witness, but we were playing together at the same time. I really enjoyed Honky Ball, and I put out their first 7-inch. I love Cast Iron Hike. I released 7-inch by them as well. I actually loved Otis. I thought that was awesome. It was like, again, like in an aggro rock and roll style, but noisy and interesting. That's what really, I was looking for.
I'm not familiar with that band, so I have to look them up.
Yeah, okay. I definitely was a fan of kind of the early Alston rock thing that was happening, like the Roadsaw people and the 8-Ball Shifter people and Bloodletter and the noisier stuff like Spore. I mean, Bloodletter was really noisy as well. That stuff was always interesting to me. And I remember talking to Ale back then, just being like, wow, I like what you're doing with this record label. It was reproductive at the time. And so I always had a fascination with that really noisy stuff. I think later on, like Juno and Neptune was happening. I liked Bright a lot. It was kind of all over the place, and that's what I loved. It was in that era, you were really able to put out a single and break up and then do something else right after, and your momentum will carry you. It wasn't a big challenge. Like the folks in Ambulance Driver, I'm not even sure what happened to most of them, but I loved that record. And it was really cool to have a show like another band, Hullabaloo, right? Hullabaloo played with us in the city. Yeah, we played with them and Sega at the Paradise. There's no one there for us. Hullabaloo came on, all of a sudden there's a bunch of people, and it was like, wow, what's this weird, rock and roll but butthole surfery band doing a cover of Back in Black with a trumpet? What the fuck? It was great. Like, I didn't understand where they came from, but I loved it. The thing you mentioned before about sort of that rock and roll music coming back into almost like the aggressive music scene, it definitely started, mid-80s when bands like SSD and DYS decided to put out rock records.
Yeah, how they rock, kind of yeah.
AC/DC type stuff, and I didn't like that stuff as much. I remember going to see... I think I was supposed to see COC and Dag Nasty. It ended up being Cancerous Growth and the Freeze, and I was a huge Freeze fan, but I always liked the way the Freeze were kind of melodic. They weren't a rock and roll band back then, but they definitely were melodic, and I had really appreciated their early stuff, the Jerry's Kids stuff. They didn't ever really go rock, but they definitely got noisier and slowed down a little bit. I think that 80s, well, it's also FU's to Sherrod Odds, right? That was another big change. But that definitely was an influence to me. So I probably was, by the time we got to that era that we're talking about, early 90s, early to mid-90s, I was either subconsciously or even consciously influenced by that changeover. And I knew that it could be done because I had seen so many good bands do it well. I knew that it could be done poorly, and I wanted to avoid that as well. But Bolt of Volta also was another band. Like, they started out pretty much rock and roll, but badass, noisy, fucked up rock and roll, and that's what I feel like.
Bolt of Volta, man. Like, I still listen to that, to The Gift, on the regular, man. That's an incredible album. And even Swan Dive has got some good tracks on it, too. And
it does, yep.
So anyone out there who Bolt of Volta is not in your everyday vernacular, look them up. They have videos on YouTube. You can get their music on Apple Music if you want to try it out. And if you're a fan of aggressive music with a lot of melody, but also a lot of aggression and heavy duty guitar rock, like, definitely check them out, man.
Yep, agreed.
And Lagratona too, man. That's I think you and I are probably the two biggest Lagratona fans on the planet Earth. And
yeah, I think so.
And more people should listen to that band as well. And that was a band that was way ahead of their time, I think, or maybe behind their time a little bit too. I don't know. Like, it's hard to say. They're either too early or too late.
That's a funny trajectory too, right? Because Slaughter Shack, which is where Colin came from, I feel like Slaughter Shack was ahead of their time, but they didn't quite have the catchy songs that they might have needed to break through anywhere. They were playing a lot of shows with like White Zombie back then. And even White Zombie's early stuff is really just kind of noisy, all over the place, but still cool sounding. And then, of course, they changed their style completely. But Slaughter Shack was a little bit more straightforward, but still super noisy. And with Colin's brutal vocals, I think some people got it. They had a little bit of success, but they didn't quite have that mass appeal. And with La Gratona, I feel like the songs were there. They really had awesome songs, even though it wasn't necessarily more melodic. He was screaming even more than Slaughter Shack. And the guitars were all over the place as far as like cool, almost Jesus Lizard style, you know, weird scales and stuff. The rhythm section was super badass. Again, just aggro, but interesting. And I think Taz was definitely one of the best drummers to come out of Boston ever. And that La Gratona record, the first La Gratona full length, showcases it really well, because in his words, I think he never wanted to play the same beat in a row twice. So he really kept things interesting. And because people could keep up with him, and then there was almost like a percussive vocalist. It was like nothing I'd heard before. You know, the closest thing might've been some Jesus Lizard or some Laughing Hyenas, or, you know, even Negative Approach type stuff. But La Gratona brought it together in a new, unique way for me.
Yeah, it's funny. I remember seeing the guys in Slaughter Shack around Alston before actually hearing the band. Like, I'd seen John Queenan around and Colin at the comic book store, the New England comic shop over there in on Alston. And I'm like, man, these guys look fucking cool, man. Like, you know, just like really cool looking guys, you know. And I'm like, they must be in a band, you know. And I found out that they're in this band called Slaughter Shack. And then I went to go check them out. And then years later, I moved away from Boston and I came back and I went to Bill's Bar and La Gratona was playing, but they were called Suicide King at that time. Mm-hmm. And I saw them on stage and I'm like, wait, this guy sounds just like that dude from that band, Slaughter Shack. And then it all sort of came together, you know?
Right. And at that comic shop, I'm pretty sure Bob Mayo from Wargasm worked. I'm pretty sure he worked there.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, another of my favorite bands from around here, which I haven't mentioned yet. Like, that first Wargasm album is just mind-blowingly good. Super catchy, but super energized, and the technicality is there, but the caveman-ness is there, too. They were just channeling Tank, and I didn't even know who Tank was when I heard that Wargasm record, but now I listen to Tank, and I go, okay, I see where it came from. Yeah. But they, you know, they still were unique in their own right, and incredibly catchy, but still technical and memorable lyrics. Really interesting band overall, especially for a three piece. Unbelievable.
When I talk to other people in bands, and they think about their back catalog and their past work and their different releases and whatnot, and can you listen to Only Living Witness records and be satisfied with it? Like, do you? Because I know a lot of musicians find fault where there might not be any fault sometimes. Like, they might listen to it and they're like, okay, well, there's like, I was out of key a little bit here. I hit this cue like a little bit late. Now, how do you, or can you at all enjoy any of this old music, especially since it came out like, you know, so long ago? Do you have a different perspective on it these days?
I put it on and I kind of cringe, but I can understand why other people enjoy it. I definitely enjoyed it. Or I wouldn't have done it back then, you know. I don't listen to it as much as I did, obviously, back then. But sometimes I'll put on, especially the second record, where I feel like we're a little bit more mature songwriters, and I'll really enjoy it. The first record, I like the songs, but I can hear so many parts that are kind of naive and overwrought. Maybe the song goes on a little too long. We definitely shouldn't have had that guitar solo, that kind of thing. I feel like the second record, we got to a point where we were putting songs together that were much more interesting. I had a better time singing them. I was more relaxed. I was more loose, and I can hear that in my own voice. So that was, that's easier for me to digest nowadays than hearing, you know, basically 21-year-old Jonah Jenkins yelling when he probably should have been relaxed and getting more into the music. It's never easy to go back and listen to things, you know, 27 years later.
Yeah, definitely.
And I feel like I'd rather listen to other people's music, and that's not because I'm embarrassed or anything like that. It's just like it's like hearing yourself talk, you know, conversation where you hear something recorded on a phone call or something like that. I know I'm going to listen back to this phone call and go, oh God, I sound like that.
Yeah, it's a weird subjectivity that happens, and it's, I don't know, everyone has a different answer to that question. It's like, I can't bear to listen to anything that I play on or have anything to do with, so, because I can hear every little mistake I ever made, and it's unlistenable to me. But yeah, it's good that, I don't know. It's an interesting thing that people that make music have, that could, their relationship with their art, you know, is very interesting.
Right.
You know.
Definitely. I mean, I'm sure that there are people that hate music, you know, 50 years ago that listened to it and they go, all right, yeah, I'm still happy with that, no problem, because it was a very different kind of music. If you're talking about someone who wrote a rockabilly song or a blues song or an early rock and roll song, no, that's what it was. It was just perfect. You know, they had this vision. It just happened, and it was captured very quickly and organically. Sometimes what I hear on recordings from the 90s is like that super echoey snare and, you know, a lot of over-processing, and I really don't like that part of it either, never mind my own performances.
Recently, there's been some announcements of Milltown shows, and you were the vocalist in that band, and that was a very, let's see, what's a good way to describe Milltown? Kind of an unlikely grouping of people, in my opinion. How did that whole band sort of form?
So I had started to look around for people to play with immediately after Witness broke up. I was approached by Jake from Cast Iron Hike about potentially doing something with this guy, Brian McKernan. And I met Brian. We talked about it. We had similar interests, at least with regard to like melodic hardcore and melodic punk rock that we knew, some rock and roll at the time. We didn't really have a strong plan for how to make it happen, but he was in his old studio in Brighton, Salad Days. And at the same time, since nothing was really getting off the ground too quickly, I had reached out to Errol Shepard, who had recently left Roadsaw, and talked with him about forming a band. So he and Bob Maloney and I, Bob Maloney's now in Worshipper, and Bob Maloney also played bass when Only the Witness went over for our last show in Eindhoven in 2009. So it was me, Bob Maloney, and Daryl. We formed what eventually would become Milligram, but neither band had a drummer at the time. So I had actually been approached by Warner Brothers for, you know, to see whether or not it was going to be possible to get me out of my contract with Century Media. So that was sort of percolating, and basically they said, you know, you tell us which band you want to be on Warner Brothers, and Milltown got a drummer first. Or a consistent drummer.
Okay.
Yeah. Around that same time, Aaron Hydrahead had reached out, Aaron Turner, he had reached out to say, hey, would you be interested in putting out an EP on Hydrahead? And I was like, are you kidding me? I love your label. It's really cool. I think the Milltown EP ended up being number 9 on his label, but he had already put out a bunch of really cool stuff. And I wasn't quite sure what would come of those songs, but we getting into a basement, you know, recording quickly because Brian's gear was all set up. We ended up having that EP come out first, so Milltown had a little bit more momentum. There were a bunch of Milligram songs that were written, but not quite fleshed out because we couldn't find a consistent drummer. Right after Milltown broke up, I immediately reformed Milligram, and we put out a couple records with Zeph on drums. Zeph Courtney from Stompbox. You have another good band from around here.
Yeah, Stompbox. Well, formerly Built Spear.
Yes.
That was their original name, yeah.
Yeah. Which was always strange to me because I knew Blitz Spear, and I was like, wait, what's going on here?
Yeah, exactly.
but yeah, it's it was kind of a strange group of people to be playing music together because Brian and Matt were in Ashes. And I don't think Milltown sounds anything like Ashes, but you know, they had started writing songs, and they were pretty melodic songs. They had a female vocalist, so it was not the same dynamic for them at all. But the songwriting was, they had already started thinking about writing cool songs. So, Jay and Rob ended up joining, and it worked out well as far as like writing a bunch of songs that we were happy about, and that came together very quickly. I had a bunch of ideas already because I had been thinking about stuff for the next, whatever was supposed to be the next Witness record. And although it wasn't nearly as aggressive, I really needed to take a break from that like tough guy scene that Witness was, you know, kind of refugees from, because like You know, I just wanted to play music and wanted to enjoy it. And Boston at the time was way too engaged with like just fighting for, you know, just fighting to music. So Milltown was a really logical progression for me. Milligram would have also been, because that was more like straight up rock and roll. We were more influenced by like Mainliner and stuff. But like the Milltown stuff, you know, we really liked a lot of DC hardcore and the melody that came from that. And so we ended up doing a couple 7 inches. One was with Joni from NBR, and that was a split with Cast Iron Hike. And then we went right into the studio to record for Warner Brothers, and we recorded 18 songs. It never came out because basically there was a coup within the record label where there was invading, and our project was sabotaged. So this is in the words of the guy who signed it. So that didn't come out, and now that's sitting in a vault somewhere. I don't know if it'll ever come out, but we never got to really fully mix it either. One interesting thing there, we recorded in the same studio where they recorded Eye Against Eye, and it's a place, Longview Farm, where there was a stage built in the barn where the Rolling Stones were practiced for the Tattoo U record. That was around the same time that the Rolling Stones played in Worcester at Sir Morgan's Cove. They used to have a plaque on the wall to commemorate that. But we stayed there. We were there for about a month and a half recording it. I stayed in the Keith Richards suite, which was really ridiculous. It was like underground, no windows. So he could sleep all day. And wow. It was connected to the sauna. Connected to the room that had the hot tub in it. There was like a pool table and whatever. We played video games all the time, and it was a really eye-opening experience. But we spent way too much money, and we had initially just wanted to record with Brian. You know, the record label was not having that. They were like, no. But one of the most ridiculous aspects of that recording session was that I think we probably spent about $16,000 one day putting microphones up in the cupola at the top of the barn, so that Ron St. Germain, who was the guy who recorded Eye Against Eye, could dive bomb with his plane, and we recorded the sound of his plane dive bombing the barn, and that made it onto the record.
Wow.
But we spent too much money doing that silliness.
That's crazy, man. And this record right now, it's like that record just is locked away in a vault somewhere, and it's, you know.
Yeah, it's been, you know, I think we've got 10 songs rough mixed, and those have made their way on the internet. So, I mean, people can still hear some of those songs. I think it says unreleased demo, you know, but it's just probably never going to get released. I think they'd want too much money for it because we spent too much money.
Yeah. So why reform and do these shows? Like, what's the, is there a game plan, like, with any of this stuff, this activity that you guys have going on?
The main reason we had talked about it was to do a recording of these songs that we could officially release, because we own all the songs, we just don't own the recording. And since Brian's been doing so well with his studio, we knew we could just go in, do a quick version of each song, and it would sound good, it would be natural, and we were going to release that officially. As soon as some friends started hearing about that, they were like, oh, you guys have to play a show. So Nate Newton from Converge came to us and asked if we wanted to play this, you know, these Cave-In benefit shows for the Cave-In, these two shows at the Sinclair. And we were like, yeah, are you kidding me? That'd be amazing. So hopefully, you know, we're not going to be nearly as great as Cave-In is going to be, but we'll play those songs and we'll play them well, and we're going to be, you know, psyched to play them. When we got together recently to practice, we literally hadn't played together in 20 years.
Yeah.
And it was cool to be able to just kind of fire up the songs. And after a few songs, a lot of muscle memory kicked in and it sounded pretty good. We won't be, you know, road ready with the songs, obviously, because the practices have been few and far between, but the songs sound good, and I'm really psyched to be playing them.
Cool. That's great, man. What are the dates of these upcoming shows? Like, where are they? Where and when are they?
Yes, the Sinclair in Cambridge, and that is Cambridge, Massachusetts, and the dates are October 19th and 20th. I think they just released a few more tickets for each of those shows.
Cool. So, yeah, if you're in the New England area, this will be up prior to that show, so hopefully you can check out the Milltown reunion. Now, what I'm most excited about is the Northern Skulls, and I have to thank you for sending me this incredible package contained within a hand-painted mailer, basically. It's like the whole thing is like an art project, and I appreciate that very much, Jonah.
Sure, man.
So what's the story with the Northern Skulls, man? It's
yeah. I don't know how to describe it really, except it came together pretty quickly, and it's been really fun to play with these guys. The drummer is Mike from Scratch.
Okay.
The bass player is Glenn Stilfen from Scratch and from Gangrene. I've been wanting to play with Mike for a long time. He was actually my first choice to play in Milligram. And so when this band came together, I was psyched that he was going to be in it. And the guitar player is Johnny Mullen, and he's been in a bunch of bands, including 10-5 Vipers and Scrapes, mostly like punk rock stuff. So he's got a real straightforward, noisy, high-indie guitar style that I'm wanting to play with, sing with for a long time. And I had never had an opportunity. So to hear these songs the way we've brought them together has been kind of pretty exciting. They came together really fast. We actually did a Milltown cover because they had heard it and they were like, hey, maybe we can get an EP together pretty quickly if we try that one. And it had never been released officially. So we did a song called 8645, and we did a Husker Du cover. And then we wrote four more songs, and we recorded those with Benny Grotto at Mad Oak. Mad Oak is owned by Craig Riggs of Roadsaw, who we mentioned earlier.
So now, I got this in the mail as a gift, but where can other people buy this record?
So we've been mainly just selling it through Bandcamp, and it's been sent out to a few of the shops in the New England area, but not too many. I think the easiest way is through Bandcamp, because that way you get the lowest price, and if you do it that way, I'll also send a hand-painted mailer to you as well. I think I sent out about 100 of them so far, and it's just the basic standard white cardboard mailer. I think I told you, Mike, the initial ones that I sent out, I was putting the art on the outside. But on some of those, the labels would fall off and they'd get returned to me and stuff because the paint would easily dissolve in the rain or something like that. But so I started putting the art on the inside now, and I guess that's probably better because it preserves more of the artwork. It's all acrylic and pen ink and color and stuff.
And also, it's a nice surprise when you open up this package and it's got this beautiful hand-painted interior. And I was like kind of blown away by that. I was like, wow, look at this, man. It's like, and the what I ended up getting reminded me of like a later Husker Du kind of album cover. You know what I mean? Like I could see this being a Husker Du record cover, and I was like, wow, this is really
nice.
Cool. And, I spun the vinyl. It sounds cool. I like it a lot.
Mm-hmm.
There's, it's a heavy rock thing going on, but there's also this very faint, almost like Swerve Driver kind of thing going on in a couple of the songs.
Oh yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I like that.
Yeah. You know, there's like this, cause Swerve Driver gets lumped in with like My Bloody Valentine and, Slow
right.
Dive and all these bands, but they were like a little bit more of a hard rock band than the bands I just mentioned. And Northern Skulls have a little bit of that element in their music, in my opinion. So,
I appreciate that. That's awesome.
Yeah, it makes like a really cool mix of, hard driving rock music and then this kind of like British early 90s kind of thing going on, which I really appreciate all that too.
Yeah, I've always been a fan of Swerve Driver. In fact, when I went on a tour with was Witness opening for Leeway, I only had three cassettes with me. One was the dub that I had gotten from a record dude, this guy, Jem Oswald. He gave me a copy of Sky Valley before it was released, and it was like the weekend before we went on tour. So I had a copy of Sky Valley, a copy of Swerve Driver, Mezcal Head, and then I had one of the first shows we played over there. Someone had heard that I was a Tori Amos fan, so they gave me a cassette with a live Tori Amos set on it.
Oh, wow. Damn.
So those are the only three tapes I had for the whole tour, and the tour was like a month long. So I listened to a lot of Swerve Driver, and that record in particular is one of my favorites. But I definitely have been a fan of that driving but melodic style.
Yeah, that's a great record by them, man. And you know what? Their newer records are actually really good too. I don't know if you're even
definitely.
Yeah, I didn't even know that they were still functioning as a band, and then one day I just looked on Apple Music and there's like three albums that came out in the last 5 years, and they're all pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, they are good, and they're still great live. Like, I've seen them recently, and it's pretty awesome that they're able to maintain that level of energy. And I like how dense the sound is. There's a lot going on. Like you said, people put them in a category with My Bloody Valentine, and maybe that's because of that density, the sheer volume and all the cool tones that are coming off that stage.
Yeah, that's probably what it is. So you talked about touring Europe. I mean, with Century Media being, you know, even back then, a pretty big presence in Europe, I imagine the touring over there was pretty successful for Only Live and Witness.
Yeah, we had a great bunch of shows. I don't think there were any shows that we really were disappointed with, even when there was nobody there. Like, we played some just incredible places. You know, it was either like the location and the view from the stage was amazing, or we played in a really cool little like cafe or something like that. And then the big shows, because we were on tour the first time with Cro-Mags, the second time with Leeway, we played some pretty big shows, especially when we would connect with like the Sick of It All tour, especially last time we went over there. Some of those shows were great, and I feel like it was, you know, I wouldn't trade it for anything. It was absolutely one of my favorite experiences in my life, being able to be in a new European city every day. And I had a great job at the time, so I could come back and pay my rent. It wasn't like I was, you know, eating ramen either before or after. I could actually, enjoy the time that I was over there, not dreading coming home. It's not like we were making any money because the t-shirt sales were all going to the record label, but still, like, being in Prague in 93, like, talking to the kids in the street that, you know, were still kind of jubilant because of the revolution that had just happened there. They're like, we are devastatingly poor, but we are really excited about the future. And then I went back, you know, I think 2009, I was in Prague again, and just having that knowledge of the history, the firsthand knowledge of what people were saying in the street back, you know, 93, and then seeing it again in 2009, I was like, wow, it's amazing to see that kind of history happening.
Yeah, totally, man. Kind of a creepy story, which involves me and you and the Red Line, or I'm sorry, the bus that takes you from Harvard Square through Lower Alston. I remember when I used to take the bus, I think, with the same basic schedule you did during the day to and from work. Because I recognized you as being the singer from Only Live and Witness one day. And I was like, oh, that's the guy from Only Live and Witness. I remember you talking about the Cro-Mags tour with whoever you were sitting next to. And I was like, wow, that must be cool, man, to go over to Europe and tour. And I hope someday I can do something like that. That was really interesting, man. It was just funny. I never told you that all these years.
No, wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I worked at Harvard, so I must have been like heading over to the libraries.
Yeah. Yeah, it was that whatever that bus line that goes up Harvard Ave or Harvard Street through Lower Alston.
66, I think.
The 66
bus. 66.
Yeah.
Yeah, and after a while, I was like, the bus was so slow that eventually I just started walking to work.
I started doing the same thing, man. Like, I would take the Red Line, and I would think about taking the bus, and then I'm like, you know what, man, I'm just going to hoof it, and it's just a better walk, and, you know, because rather than just sitting on a bus all day, you know, for however long it took, you know. But anyway, Jonah, thank you very much. I'm glad we were able to chat about, you know, all this stuff.
Thank you, man.
And I'm looking forward. I mean, I'm going to be in Massachusetts in the next few weeks, and I'm going to see if I can line up showing up at one of those gigs.
Well, let me know if you need a ticket. I can definitely get one for you. We have some extras. It's a benefit, so they're you know, kind of cracking down on the guest list. But we all bought a bunch of tickets just in case because we have friends that want. Yeah, so keep me posted. It's easier to get you something for the 20th, which is the Sunday show.
Okay.
But yeah, if you can make it, cool. If you can't, hey, we'll hang out another time. That's totally fine.
Sounds good, man. All right, dude.
Yeah.
Have a good day. Take care.
Thank you. You, mate. Have a good one.
Bye-bye.
That's it for this week's episode of Metal Matters, a Gimme Radio weekly podcast. Tune in next week and see what we have in store for you. The show is available on all streaming platforms, Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Spotify, etc. Also, be sure to check out Gimme Radio, streaming on the web, iOS, or Android, for one of the best metal communities, exclusive merch, interviews with artists, and so much more. I'll catch you guys next week. Take care.